Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentioned that قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. That he says, he commands the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say this to all of the companions, that O Muhammad, say to the companions, that O my beloved servants, those who have transgressed upon themselves, do not despair from the mercy of Allah. Right? Don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Inna Allah yaghfiru dhunuba jami'a. Why? Because certainly Allah will forgive all of your sins. Innahu huwa al-ghafuru rahim. Certainly the forgiving and all the merciful. And this is a verse that is very, very important, and it is a verse that unfortunately many people they forget. Unfortunately many people who have made mistakes in their life, they feel guilty about what they've done. But then what happens, shaitan uses this to his opportunity and he tries to fill this person's heart with negativity. Okay? We need to understand something, that negativity is from shaitan. Right? This is shaitan's job. That when you want to change, the one way, one tactic he uses against you is he uses this guilt trip that, you've sinned so much, what's the point of you going back to Allah now? Right? Allah's not going to forgive you. Right? This is what shaitan makes you think. Right? And he makes you have negative minds, negative thoughts about Allah. But you see, this verse is very, very powerful and very, very important for us as believers. And it's very important for our personal lives, and it's also very, very important to share with our friends and family. The fact that Allah is addressing specifically those people who have, spent their entire life in the disobedience of Allah. Allah is not addressing by saying that, all believers who have been so good in this life. Allah not saying that, oh muttaqeen, oh pious ones, oh righteous ones, oh God-conscious ones. Allah not saying that. Allah is saying, oh people who have oppressed themselves, oh people who have disobeyed themselves so much. Those very people who haven't prayed a single salah in their lives, right? The believers, they haven't prayed a single salah in their life. They haven't, obeyed the commands of Allah in a single, a single time in their life. They spent their entire lives, 50, 60 years, some of them, subhanAllah, in the disobedience of Allah. But now, they want to change. It's never too late. They want to change. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing these people, right? That's why Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, when he was passing away, he, famous statement about him, that he said that, oh Allah, I've got so much sin, it's like the mountains, right? I've got so much sin, it's like the mountains. This is who Imam Shafi'i, right? When you study about the taqwa of Imam Shafi'i, he's on a different level, right? And he's saying this, that he's saying that my sins have reached the tips of the mountain. But oh Allah, when I measure my sins to your mercy, I find that your mercy is far, far greater. Right? This is Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah speaking. Okay? And this is, the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the hadith mentions in Sahih Bukhari, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that Allah maktubun fawq al-arsh, that this statement is written above the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that inna rahmati sabaqat ghadabi, that certainly my mercy has overcome my anger. My mercy has overcome my anger. However, one thing we need to bear in mind, it doesn't mean that, mashallah, we come laid back and we do whatever you want and say, oh, yeah, Allah is merciful, He's going to forgive me. Right? The ulama and even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions that al-imanu bayna al-khawfi wa raja, that iman is a balance between fear and hope. Right? And this is what everyone needs. As believers, we need to have fear in us being accounted on the Day of Judgment, fear of the punishments of Allah, etc. But we also at the same time need to have a balance. We need to have that hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. And this, this fear and hope will play at different times in our lives. Sometimes, alhamdulillah, Allah has given you the ability, especially in Ramadan, where, we're doing good deeds, etc. And, and this is where we still need to have fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because we need to have fear that will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept my ibadah, right? Even though, alhamdulillah, I've done so much good deeds in this Ramadan, but is it enough to achieve the forgiveness of Allah? We need to have that fear, we need to have that anxiousness, right? As Allah mentioned in the Quran, this is a sign of the believers, that they're anxious of the Day of Judgment, they're anxious of the punishments of Allah, they're anxious whether the ibadah is going to be accepted or not. But when a person in his life, he goes through different spells in his life, right? Sometimes he's going through a bad spell and he's disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is when the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kicks in. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that this is what a person needs to have a balance between these two things. Fear and hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a very, very important verse that inshallah we need to remember. Moving on to the last few verses of Surah Az-Zumar, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he talks about how the disbelievers will be brought to Jahannam and how the believers, the muttaqeen, will be brought to Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِلَى جَهَنَّمَ زُمْرًا, that that those who disbelieve, they will be led to Jahannam in groups. Okay, they will be led to Jahannam in groups. And then it will be said to him, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُهَا فُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا. When they come, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make them wait for a bit, right? And then he will open, you know, because they say, الْإِنْتِظَارُ وَشَدُّ مِنَ الْمَوْتِ, right? You're waiting for the punishment, right? But in that, you know, that waiting in and of itself is a punishment, right? When you're waiting for, you know, bad, because when you're waiting for something, that in itself is a punishment, let alone the punishment itself, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُهَا, that when they approach Jahannam, they will wait there for a slight amount of time, and I'll explain why, you know, I'm explaining it as in this way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, eventually he will open the gates of Jahannam, and it will be said to them that, you know, enter Jahannam, but then they will complain and they will say, oh, you know, have mercy upon us, etc., as Allah mentioned in other verses. And then it will be addressed to them, you know, people, the gatekeeper of Jahannam, Malik, his name is Malik, right? He will say that أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّنْكُمْ يَتْلُونَ عَلَيْكُمْ آيَاتِ رَبِّكُمْ وَيُنذِرُونَكُمْ لِقَاءَ يَوْمِكُمْ هَذَا. He will say that didn't messengers from amongst you come to you reciting the verses of your Lord upon you, and weren't you warned about this day wherein you will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Did all of this thing happen during the time? And they will have to confess. They can't lie, right? They will have to confess. And this is when it will be said to them that, you know, there's no way out for you. Okay? And this is, you know, it's very, very scary verse, subhanAllah. It's a big wake-up call for us, right? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he saved us, you know, subhanAllah, from being from these people. And thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions, you know, taqwa, those people who have taqwa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that, وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا رَبَّهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ زُمَرًا. That those who have got consciousness of their Lord, they will be led to Jannah, to paradise in groups. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُهَا وَفُتِحَتْ أَبْوَابُهَا. Until when they come to the gates of Jannah, before they even arrive, the door will be open for them. Before they even arrive, the door will be open for them. How do you understand that? Because of this wow. Those who study Arabic grammar will understand this. That this wow is giving the meaning of something happening very, very quickly. Right? And this is the difference. In the first verse, when Allah was talking about disbelievers, he said, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءُهَا فُتِحَتْ, without the wow. There's no word futihat, just futihat, which gives the meaning of them waiting for a short amount of time and then entering it, right? It's just like, you know, when you're receiving guests, right? You see from the window that the cars come, right? They're getting out of the car. Before they even knock, what do? You open the door and you greet them with a big smile, right? And those people that you don't like, they'll come to your house, right? You haven't invited them, they come to your house. What do? You wait for a bit and say, shall I open the door, shall I not open the door, right? And they're waiting around, etc. Then eventually you open the door, right? In the same way, when the believers are led to Jannah, subhanAllah, the angels will be waiting there, right? The angels will be waiting there. And before they even arrive, the doors in the gates of Jannah will be open for them. And what will happen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that when they arrive at the gates of Jannah, it will be said, Salamun alaykum. That the gatekeepers of Jannah, they will say, they will greet with this person with salam, indicating towards the virtue of saying assalamu alaikum. Not only is it a greeting in this world, but it also means the greeting, okay, for the people of Jannah as well. So, and what do we say after that? After they greeted them, they will say tibbutun, that you've done excellent in this world. Right? You've done excellent. You know, when you're a teacher, and you marked an exam and you got, you know, full marks, and they say, you know, you did fantastic. How good does the student feel? The student feels absolutely amazing, right? In the same way, when we pass this exam, inshallah, we ask Allah that Allah gives us a tawfiq, right? To pass this exam, it's the greatest exam. That when, inshallah, we pass this exam, we have to have hope, we pass this exam, the angels will be commanded to say from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the angel will tell us that, you know what, you did absolutely fantastic, right? It's just like, let me give you another example. Maybe not the teacher, he doesn't tell you because the teacher's a bit, you know, is a bit tight, right? But other teachers, they've looked at the exam, right? Other teachers, they've looked at the exam, they're not marking your paper, but they say, no, I looked at your exam, it looks pretty solid. Right? How beautifully proper good, right? So in the same way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell these angels that, you know, tell my servants who are entering Jannah that they did absolutely fantastic in this world, right? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those people, right? So they will say, tibbutum, that you did fantastic, fadkhuluha khalidin, enter in Jannah forever and ever. And then what will they say? They say, alhamdulillahi alladhi sadaqana wa'da. Alhamdulillahi alladhi sadaqana wa'da. All praise belongs to Allah who made his promise true. Right? He promised Jannah for those people who fear Allah, those people who act righteously in this world. And then they will say, that's why in other verses they will say, Alhamdulillah alladhi adhaba anna al-hazan. That all praise belongs to Allah who has removed all sadness and grief from us. This is going to be a ni'mah within itself. Why? Because this world is full of sadness and full of grief. One of the bounties of Jannah is that there will be no sadness and no grief. Right? So they will say, enter therein forever and ever. And, then they will say that all praise belongs to Allah who has made His promise come true. وَأَوْرَثَنَا الْأَرْضَ نَتَبَوَّأُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ حَيْثُ نَشَاءُ. And He has given us ability to reside in Jannah wherever we desire. Wherever we desire. SubhanAllah, look at it, you know, in London itself. How cramped London is, right? And we're struggling for houses, and you know, there's no space to build any more flats, etc. All of this is happening, right? But in Jannah, subhanAllah, you know, the vastness of Jannah is going to be so big that Allah will say, go whatever you like, wherever you like. Just see what someone tells you, that go in London wherever you like and build a flat wherever you like, right? The whole London's yours, right? So build a flat wherever you like. You build it right next to, mashallah, you know, in the center of London, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the people of Jannah, He will tell them, go wherever you like and enter Jannah, not only enter Jannah, but reside wherever you like. You know, pick a spot and inshallah, the angels will build a house for you, right? We'll build a house for you. And this is one of the bounties of Jannah, subhanAllah. And thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will say, then He says that, وَتَرَى الْمَلَائِكَةَ حَافِّينَ مِنْ حَوْلِ الْعَرْشِ. That you will see the angels who will be surrounding the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّهِمْ. They will be praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why, later on, what will happen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the opening verse of Surah Al-Mu'min, He mentions the same thing, that these angels, الَّذِينَ يَحْمِلُونَ الْعَرْشِ, that those angels who carry the throne of Allah, just imagine their status, right? Just imagine their status. What will they do? They praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَيُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ, they obviously believe in Allah, وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, that they seek forgiveness for those people who believe in Allah, i.e. all of us, just imagine, all of us. Who are these? These are the angels, not any other angel, these are the angels that carry the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that surround the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And despite having such a high status, they're thinking about us. They're thinking about us, subhanAllah. And now if this does not give us hope, I don't know what gives us hope, right? The fact that these pure creations of Allah, they are thinking about us who are so filthy, we have disobeyed Allah so much, but despite this, they are still remembering us. And they're still asking Allah that, oh Allah, forgive their sins. Oh Allah, forgive their sins. And then what other dua they make? They say that, رَبَّنَا وَسِعْتَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ رَحْمًا. That, oh Allah, your mercy has encompassed everything. It has covered everything. فَغْفِرْ لِلَّذِينَ تَابُوا. That those people who are, oh Allah, those people who come and repent to you, oh Allah, please forgive them. Imagine, they're making dua for us. And thereafter they will say that, وَقِهِمْ عَذَابَ الْجَحِيمِ. And that, save them from the punishment of Jahannam. Save them from the punishment of Jahannam. Thereafter they will make more dua. Look at this. رَبَّنَا وَأَدْخِلْهُمْ جَنَّاتِ عَدْنِ الَّتِي وَعَدْتَهُمْ. That, oh Allah, grant them entry into Jannah with the, you know, that Jannah that you have promised them. Not just them. وَمَنْ صَلَحَ مِنْ آبَائِهِمْ. Even their forefathers. وَأَزْوَاجِهِمْ. Even their spouses. وَذُرِّيَّاتِهِمْ. Even their progeny. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Certainly, oh Allah, you are the all wise and you are the all mighty. Then they continue the dua. وَقِهِمُ السَّيِّئَاتِ. Oh Allah, in this world, give them the ability to stay away from evil. وَمَنْ تَقِ السَّيِّئَاتِ. Then they'll make the statement that whosoever is saved from evil, فَقَدْ رَحِمْتَ, then you have surely showed mercy upon him. Right? This is the dua, subhanAllah, that the angels are making for us as we speak. Right? And now, subhanAllah, you know, this should give us hope. This should give us motivation that if the angels are seeking forgiveness for us, if the angels are making dua for us, then why can't we spend 5-10 minutes doing tawbah, making istighfar and asking Allah to forgive our sins? Right? If the angels are doing it, subhanAllah, right? And you know, this is an amazing, you know, blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the believers. So these are the few verses, brothers and sisters, that I wanted to discuss. There's many, many other verses, but time won't allow to go into all of them. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah grants us the ability to act upon the verses, inshaAllah. Jazakumullah khairan.